Talofa, kia ora na tātou katoa toa. Welcome to Tangata Pasifika.
Si o tō ofa, mā loe lele. This is our first live show for the year. So first, here's what's on the menu. Tonga, 1 year on from the devastating Hunga Tonga-Hunga Ha’apai volcano.
We need to study their volcanic eruption history to have a prediction of when is the likely next cycle.
The community finally gets a look at the new Councillor Pasifika hub in the
This morning I woke up and I thought, well, this isn't about me. This is God's day.
And our seven stars bid farewell to the New Zealand leg of the global circuit.
It's always really special to be able to play in front of our families, and so we're cherishing every moment that we can get.
Now, mai haere mai, but first, just 2 weeks after the floods which devastated parts of Auckland and surrounding regions, another damaging weather event is on the way. Cyclone Gabrielle is expected to reach Northland on Sunday, bringing severe winds and heavy rain as it travels down country. Civil Defence is urging people to be prepared to be locked in for at least 3 days if damage is severe. The news comes as a huge blow for many Pacific families still suffering from effects of the last floods. And in a moment, we'll speak with Auckland Councillor Josephine Bartley about how they're coping and her thoughts on the coming cyclone.
Into politics now, and some of our Pasifika MPs have benefited from the reshuffle following Jacinda Ardern's resignation. Kelston MP Carmel Sepuloni makes history as the first Deputy Prime Minister of Pacific descent to new PM Chris Hipkins. First term Mana MP Barbara Edmonds moves into Cabinet as the Minister of Internal Affairs and Pacific Peoples. And Palmerston North MP Tangi Utsikere gets promoted within the Labour caucus to Chief Whip. And we catch up with the new Deputy PM in next week's show.
And still with new appointments, the Ministry for Pacific Peoples has a new CEO. She's a Geraldine Clifford Lidstone, who joins the team from the Ministry of Health, where she was Director of Pacific Health. And earlier this week, new Pacific Business Trust CEO Mary Lose was welcomed at a function in Auckland. Of Tongan and Maori descent, Lose has extensive experience in the private and public sector, including 25 years of experience in multimedia and broadcasting.
Well, to our Talanoa now, and as we heard, Cyclone Gabrielle is bearing down on the country with a threat of more devastation for families already reeling from the floods 2 weeks ago. What must they be feeling and what can they do? Joining us to share her thoughts is Auckland Councillor Josephine Bartley. Thank you for joining us on the show. Whaapai lava.
Talofa lava, mai loa lelei. Good morning. Thank you so much for having me on the show.
Our pleasure. Now, you've been out there in the coalface. You've seen a lot of the families as they've been affected by the flood. Tell us what they've been telling you and what you've seen there.
Yes, so I've been out there with our other elected members who've been going hard since last Friday when people first started contacting us about this river in their street. A lot of our people are feeling, well, quite a few that we saw in their homes were feeling like they had to fend for themselves, like they had to get themselves out of their homes while this river was flowing in their street. So pretty scary stuff out there that our communities have been dealing with. I think when they come into the evacuation centre, the ones that do come in, you know, it's a hard thing to ask for help. So, you know, when they're coming in, they're traumatised of what they've experienced. I've seen a lot of our families still staying in their homes, people expecting the army or someone to come through and help them like we see on the movies. So it's been a very, very hard time for our Pacific communities out there.
I know you've spoken out about what you've seen, and in terms of our people and the services being delivered fairly across the city, for much of South Auckland especially, do you think a lot of our community have not been served properly in this instance of the floods?
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, it's come down to our own Pasifika communities getting in there and helping each other, helping ourselves. I would love to see the army more out in South Auckland, especially in Māngele. Councillor Lotu Fuli has been running the clean-up coordination from the Māngere Evacuation Centre, which Councillor Al-Filipaina, Taua Nu'u, Nick Bakalich, the Māngere Otahu Local Board have been leading over there.
What about the council itself? I mean, obviously we've seen absolute failings that have happened here.
That's right, yes. I think we needed, for this one, going into Cyclone Gabriel, there is better planning and better coordination happening, which is a relief. There's, our mayor is stepping into the role now, putting out those preparation messages, so that's good to see. That's what we want.
But how much have things changed? Obviously, we didn't expect this to happen so soon. But even as of yesterday, sandbags were being delivered to other parts of Auckland, yet South Auckland was being missed out.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I don't know how these decisions are made, but in my mind, it would have been common sense to just put the sandbags where there's a community that's been flooded and a community where there are issues to accessing those sandbags, for example, affordability.
Okay, but they're on their way now. This morning they'll be available for people.
I understand there's going to be about 3,000 in Māngere.
Okay, we've just got a little moment to wrap up. What do you want to say to our community to be prepared?
For our communities, you take this seriously, be prepared. You could be at home for a period of time before help gets to you. So know that, you know, with this cyclone, wind will be a factor. That means trees are going to go down. That means our power is going to go out. So have 3 days' worth of water, about 9 litres per person. Have your medication in a waterproof bag, your documents, important documents, non-perishable food that you can survive on. And also a radio will be good for communication.
Councillor Bartley, Whawhtai lava, thank you for coming on the show today.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Well, stay with us. When we come back a year on from a devastating volcanic eruption and tsunami, how is the Kingdom of Tonga coping?
Moment where the underdogs, so we've been gelling together quite nicely and we have been working really hard on our connections off the field, and with that, that translates to on the field. You haven't seen the best of us, you know, it was such a short season last year and we did finish fourth, but that's really lit a fire in our team to kind of, you know, turn things around, prove people wrong. We're really focusing on game situations and game scenarios and learning our patterns. Not necessarily being like, you know, smashed into the ground. We've really found the balance within our team with the youth slash the veterans and just a mix of personalities, and just in every way we've got a really good balance. It's honestly so awesome. The theme launch today, it definitely was not what I was expecting and it exceeded my expectations in a good way, but it was pretty cool, you know. And I really haven't been in situations where there's a lot of media, so that was new to me, but I enjoyed it.
Love every minute. Sky Super Rugby Open starts February 25th live on Sky Sport. Pop, did you see that?
Oh man, I'm so excited. Honestly, this is probably the most excited I've been for an upcoming season. It's going to be amazing. You know, we're going to have our full format of how we want to play. And there's been so much more support this year than there has last year. So I'm so excited. Pretty amazing to be playing rugby here in New Zealand, but now it's just amazing, you know, doors are opening for women's rugby or women's sport in general. So I'm really looking forward to see how we as a team do compared to the other teams. Love this.
Whakalofala here to welcome back to Tagata Pasifika. It's been a year since the Hunga Tonga-Hunga Ha’apai volcano eruption in the Kingdom of Tonga. The powerful underwater volcano erupted on January 15 last year, triggering a tsunami which damaged the main island of Tongatapu while wiping out smaller neighbouring islands, leaving them uninhabitable.
And a year on, and many of those displaced by that event live in shelters or homes on Tongatapu, unable to return home for now. John was up in the kingdom last month to talk to some of the survivors and get a sense of how the country is coping.
A new home and a new beginning for the Fulau family.
Watekini
and his family were forced to leave their home on Atata, one of the outer islands near the Hunga Tonga Hunga Ha’apai volcano. The explosion sent a plume of water, ash and sulfur over 58 kilometres into the air. The ashfall that came with it covered the island kingdom in grey dust. The eruption triggering a 20-metre-high tsunami that surged over the tiny island, wiping away everything in its path. Separated from his family, Watekini stayed back to rescue his elderly mother while his wife and others fled to higher ground. They made it to safety, but sadly she passed away a few months after the ordeal. She's now buried next to the family home on the main island, Tongatapu.
Now, as part of the government's resettlement program, they've made this new community on Tonga's western side. This is Atata City, named after the island Atata, where many of the people who now live here have lost everything.
Atata is now uninhabitable, and although they are safe on Tongatapu, Watekini is haunted by the events that fateful day. Thankful to be alive and no longer homeless, other survivors are adjusting to their new surroundings. With no choice but to abandon their island, all they have now are memories to hold on to. It's a miracle they've pulled through one of the most violent explosions on Earth in 140 years.
The Hunga volcano has been compared to many other eruptions recorded in history around the world. The Krakatoa one in 1883 was the biggest so far. But what we have recorded for Hunga volcano is far bigger, four times bigger than the Krakatoa event.
The devastation claimed four lives that day, leaving a damage bill of over $90 million, and some are still displaced.
More than 80,000 people were affected by the disaster. Many of those who have lost their homes are staying in temporary accommodations like this church hall, not far from Tonga's capital, Nuku'alofa.
When aid arrived from overseas, so did COVID-19, hindering reconstruction efforts in a country still grappling with the aftermath.
A lot of the funds provided to us by development partners were put through to actually reconstructions, building small houses for the families that were affected. There were about 700 homes that were affected in our general vicinity in Tongatapu, and about 300 need to be rebuilt. We're about 80% there.
The Ha'atafu Beach Resort on the picturesque west coast of Tongatapu used to welcome tourists from all over the world has also disappeared with the tsunami waves.
In front of that used to be whale number 1 and 2, which we just don't see anymore.
A representative of the Burling family who owned the resort say they are rebuilding as they were initially a red zone.
The ultimate goal is to build back the whales and bring the accommodations back. But for now, it's probably just one step at a time, trying to establish the family home first. Hopefully we've got government support and try and keep the local staff rolling over as well in terms of securing their job security.
In looking to the future, Tonga is among the most vulnerable countries in the world to natural disasters, say scientists. We've discovered evidence of ongoing volcanic activity.
Those submarine volcanoes in the south of Hunga, we need to do further assessments to study their volcanic eruption history to have a prediction of when is the likely next cycle of eruption.
The eruption and tsunami may have devastated the kingdom, but the people here have shown tremendous resilience.
After the break, we check out the new Tagata Pasifika hub in Kirikiriroa, Hamilton, where our Seven Stars played for possibly the last time.
We were pretty gutted to hear that it would be the last home tournament for us, and so instead of thinking like that, we went into the tournament celebrating the 21 years that we've had here.
Home.
Welcome back to Tangata Pasifika. Well, it's been a remarkable 24 years in the making, and Gaute Pasifika have officially opened their Pan-Pacific Community Hub in the Waikato.
Yes, more than 1,000 people from around the region gathered in Kirikiriroa, Hamilton, to celebrate the milestone, and reporter Hanalei Fuliaki got amongst it.
A beautiful morning in Kirikiriroa, Hamilton, to celebrate the first in a series of events for the Councillor Josephine Hub, a timeless resource for the community that will provide healthcare and wellbeing services in a traditional Pacific Island village setting.
Today was an opportunity to recognise the work of our community in achieving something for them in this space, and something that's been dreamed for such a long time. And with so many hands involved in being able to deliver it, we finally got to the first stage of the opening.
It's been 24 years in the making, and among those gathered was the Honourable Aupito William Seol, who acknowledged how the history of this project has created a wealth of opportunity for the generations to come.
Every good thing comes to fruition, as you've seen. This is quite a unique project. It's a project that's been led by the community. And while it's been a collective vision, you've had one woman focusing on the health and well-being of the wider community and believing that there were injustices and that there were barriers and that there were inequities, set out to bring Pacific peoples together.
When you put a mother involved of leading something, that's formidable in its own right. You add her daughter to the mix, and without them, I don't think the vision would have come to fruition.
A generational movement that began with Leo Pepe Elisabetta Corrales, who pioneered the idea for her people, with her daughter Leo Pepe Rachel Corrales seeing it to its current state.
I'm highly elated, and this morning I woke up and I thought, well, this isn't about me, this is God's day. We could not contemplate ever having this space right in the middle of the city. But that's why I said it's God's day today, because he made it all possible for us.
It was really important to me that we showcased Pacifica excellence, because part of the struggle has been persuading people that we had the credibility and the capability to deliver on a project of this magnitude and scale. So we really wanted to be able to show that Pacific can be excellent, that we can be professional, that we can do those things off the rugby field, that we can do it in every other space.
The festivities in the whale continued for the week, which coincided with the Hamilton Sevens tournament across the road at FMG Stadium, helping to bring more community spirit to the occasion.
The beauty of being able to have what we've just seen today, our community come together in it, it's built for its purpose. And so, massive opportunity for us to see our elders in the community whare, to see our working mothers and fathers, and then our early child learning and our children just in the back of the village. The concept of whānau in that space lives in the way it's been pulled together.
Atahua. Now to sport now, as we heard, the New Zealand leg of the HSBC World Rugby Sevens Series was on in Hamilton last month, sadly for the very last time.
New Zealand will no longer be a stop in the series as World Rugby transitions into a new format for the competition. But that didn't stop Pacific teams and their fans converging on the Tron for the fun and a farewell. Here's Hanalei.
Famed for its festive culture, the Wellington Sevens was one of the most popular events on the annual Sevens circuit. But new rules toned down the party atmosphere, leading to a move to Kirikiriroa, Hamilton in 2018.
It's been two decades that Aotearoa has hosted the World Sevens Series, and here in Hamilton will be the last time this competition takes place on New Zealand soil.
We've currently got 10 to 11 tournaments on the series each year, and World Rugby's decided to condense that down to 7. Their catchphrase is 7 iconic events in 7 iconic cities, and they've decided that in the short term that New Zealand doesn't feature as part of that. But the idea behind what they're doing is great, which is they want to drive more revenue through those 7 big tournaments that they can then reinvest back in all the participating teams. We're really hopeful that their ideas about generating more revenue that can go back to New Zealand and Fiji and Samoa and Tonga and all the participating countries comes true. If it does, that'll be good, and then we'll use some of that to reinvest in sevens and create our own tournament.
Down on the pitch, Samoan Black Fern Teresa Fitzpatrick is well aware of the significance of this event.
We were pretty gutted to hear that it would be the last home tournament for us, and so instead of thinking like that, we went into the tournament celebrating the 21 years that we've had here in New Zealand. You know, it's always really special to be able to play in front of our families, and so we're cherishing every moment that we can get.
Obviously, you know, we always come to a tournament and hoping to go out there, play our best and raise that trophy, and it'll be that more special if we can in front of the home crowd for one last time.
Among the 15 core teams taking part, the Pacific Nations bring a lot of flair to the competition, and their fans came out to cheer on their teams.
Fiji till I die. I'm going to cheer for Fiji all the time. And not only the Fiji team, the Pacific team as well.
Even though we're all different from different islands, we all come together and support like each and every island that comes on the field.
The crowd today has just been incredible. Amazing colour, particularly from the Pacifica supporters. The Fijian game was something incredible to witness earlier today. So it's a fan event, isn't it? And we love it.
On the field, Fiji fans had to temper their enthusiasm when their women's and men's team failed to make the playoffs, as did Samoan fans. Recent tournament winners in Cape Town, Samoa's men's team also failed to make the playoffs. New Zealand fans had more to celebrate. The All Black Sevens made their final but were pipped by Argentina, while the Black Fern Sevens continued on their winning way with another solid tournament win.
This one's a little bit extra special. Obviously, with it being the last Hamilton Sevens, we really wanted to make it our best one, and to be able to go back-to-back at home is extra special as well. So thank you so much.
Nice one. Well, that's the end of our show. Remember, you can watch the stories again on tpplus.co.nz or TVNZ Plus.
And go to our social media platforms too.
And if you're in the capital today, why not check out the Wellington Pasifika Festival at Waitangi Park? The festival kicks off at midday and goes until 6 p.m. Malo pito homo mea mai, kamo mea.
Stay safe, stay dry, tō whāsui pua.
Nisa mo de mana.
People of the stars, to our new homebound, Tangata Pasifika, born a people proud.